Good afternoon, cloud community, and welcome back to KubeCon CloudNativeCon here in London, England. We are coming to the end of day two of our 3 days of coverage here on theCUBE. My name is Savannah Peterson, bringing you the best and the most brilliant humans on the show floor with Rob Strechet every single day.
Yes, getting through, powering through, but today has been energizing. We've had such great guests.
We really
have. Once again, it's not hump day, but it's definitely just an energizing day, and we've been talking AI a lot today.
Yes, we have. So. And we've been talking to a lot of the people that were on the stage, just like our next guest, Idit Levine. Thank you so much for being here. It's so nice to have you.
Thank you so much for having me. It's great.
So, I was impressed. As one of the many overachievers in this room, you power-packed, I'm looking at how much it is, a lot into your five-minute talk today. Can you give us a little bit of the key takeaways there?
Yeah, sure. So, I mean, I think we started by basically sharing what we feel that's happening right now in the cloud native ecosystem, which is basically for years that we're trying to kind of like get the last piece, the last mile, which is networking in the cloud native, and I basically make a bold statement that I feel that this is now complete and optimized. So that's where we started. That was the first part of the, and we explain why, of course, and what is the building block. But then we move to the second piece of it, which we basically talk about how amazing that's giving us an opportunity, because we basically finished that piece just in time for the biggest transformation of the century, which is basically AI. So that's allowing us right now to take our focus, stay there, right? Most of the customers are there, but also build the future. And the future is AI. So the question is that, what do we need to do as a community for the infrastructure? That's what usually we build. Can we use it? There's a gap, do we need to cover it? And that's basically, and we announced some cool stuff there.
Well, tell us about some of those announcements and what you're building, because it is such a critical, like you said, the technology of the century. So yeah, feel free to list it off for us.
Yeah. So, as I said, on the networking path, our job there is more like, it's traditional, right? So what we're trying to do right now is basically just help customers adopt. So we build a lot of tooling that help them adopt with zero, the stuff that you will expect people to do, just make it easier, because this technology that we build right now, and again, we got it wrong. So we needed to kind of like, get it better. So in the beginning, Istio honestly was a full blown, it's too much, the service mesh, and the service mesh had that like bad name because of it. But we actually right now basically rebuild it in a way more slimmer and way more thought about the user, right? About the people who, I think that we did a way better job and actually listened to the user this time. And I feel that, honestly, like we're saving tons of money for people in production, security, and so on. So the word there is basically that this complete, but we make everything for people to make it easy to adopt. To the next one, okay, this is my vision. I don't know if this vision is right or not, but I really genuinely believe that the same transformation that we had for microservices, which basically, moving from monolithic to microservice, needed to build this. That's how we created that amazing community. And basically, there was now the, we took a full-blown binary, cut it to little pieces, and now we reconnected them, right? I feel that that now the application changed, and I think this is something that people miss. It's not going to be microservices anymore in the future. They're going to be agent. An agent act differently, look differently, scale differently, need to be secure differently. And I feel that this is kind of like, as a technologist, which I am, it's just so fun, because now there is a new set of problems that we need to solve. So what we announced there is a few things. The first building block, you need to build those agents, right? And again, those agents will look differently, you will scale them differently. So we started by basically creating something called K-Agent. And K-Agent is basically the framework. We basically took the framework of what the AI companies do. We took specifically for Microsoft, AutoGen, which we believe is the best. So therefore, we basically took it and basically brought it to this ecosystem. Make it Kubernetes native, and very easy, declarative, everything that you can imagine that we need here for this market, and run it on Kubernetes, of course. And then once we have that piece, right, of the orchestration, now we can build the infrastructure below. So what are those infrastructures? So for instance, the biggest thing in the market right now, the innovation that everybody's talking about is MCP. And there is a lot of, I can say my opinion about MCP, but I will argue that, in my opinion, what's good about MCP is that it's a standard finally we all agree, oh my God, this is amazing, because there's everyday new things, and how do you actually reasonable about it? So I feel that it's good that it's a spec, and I think that though what will happen right now is, you know, we need to understand how to get it better, how to make it enterprising, which is what we're working on. So we announced today MCP Gateway, which I think it's really going to help people to consume this, and that's a very important piece of the puzzle.
Yeah,
so.
Yeah, I mean, we were talking before, and I'm quoted on a Tech Target article yesterday saying that MCP is kind of a science project, and I think this is before I knew what you were announcing today with Gateway, and I think Gateway solves some of my concerns around MCP, about scale and being able to be easier. You have one single endpoint instead of a whole ton of endpoints.
Yeah.
So I did learn from your talk earlier today.
Yeah.
But I also thought that one of the things that was really good was some of the donations that you guys actually made back in Salt Lake, and how you've made it easier to upgrade to ambient and be able to go sidecarless and things of that nature. Because to me, to your point about how do we get people to adopt service mesh, that would seem like a big piece of it, is getting people to adopt service mesh, is, to your point, making it easier. Because that's what we hear from the end users, is everything is still too hard. In particular, upgrade is too hard.
Yeah.
So is that what drove a lot of that?
So I mean, honestly, we started as a company that doing Gateway and STO in the community. And we work with customers. We have, you know, over 200 customers, very different scales, but mainly like big organizations. So the question is that, how do you adopting it and how do you operate it? Working with all those customers make us understand that we didn't do it well. We built it for ourselves, but we are a very different company. So the question is, and Google, right, was big partner there. We just figure out that the way we did it, we didn't think about the end user. We thought about ourselves. Yes, this functionality is important. Adoption, you know, it's really, really hard. So I think that like 2 years ago, we actually partnered with Google and announced Ambien. And what we did is Solo engineer and Google engineer worked together to actually put the first initiative, and then we sent it to the community. And I feel that honestly, this was a refresh to the service mesh, because people started to basically decide not to adopt it. And the reason is because they said, yeah, there's the benefit. That's why there was excitement in this in the beginning, but it's too hard. So the trade-off wasn't, you know, everything is trade-off in life.
Right.
It wasn't trade-off.
It wasn't worth changing anything.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So what we did, you know, by doing this, we basically, I feel, got to the point right now that honestly, like, we brought customer to production in 3 weeks, which is insane.
Whoa.
Yes, 3 weeks is there. But not only this, even the user experience of once you're in production, let's say that there is an MC, you know, some CV that you need to fix. Before that, you needed to reach out to the community, to the application team and figure out how they're working together, tell them, listen, we're going to upgrade, we're doing restart. Honestly, like, that's kind of like defeat the purpose of service mesh. You're supposed to abstract your network and decouple those stuff, right? So basically, I think that now we got it right. And I feel that now that it's right, there's two things that we need to do. First of all, tell the world that it's right. Because honestly, we got it wrong. Some people already doesn't want to touch it. So we need to tell them, guys, this problem still exists, and we finally fix, you know, solve it right. That's number one. And number two that I feel is that, you know, make it easier, first of all, what we did already in Salt Lake City, to adopt. That's for Greenfield. But what about Brownfield? I already have STO. So that's what we did right now. Basically move them with one touch of a button, show them. So I mean, honestly, like, I feel right now we got it. Like, I mean it, finally.
I trust you.
Yeah.
I believe you. That enthusiasm. So I'm curious, you mentioned you'd built it for yourself beforehand, then you come back to the community and your customers. What was that feedback loop look like? How did you get to rebuild with the confidence that you were going to actually deliver this time?
So honestly, like, in the beginning, we have customers, they're running in production, we saw a lot of pain, and we discovered that basically not like other open source projects in STO, the old STO, you know, the original STO, it's really, really hard to adopt it unless you have, first of all, like 10 PhDs, you know, engineers that basically working on this full time. And so seriously, it's an army of people to operate it. And second of all, it's just very hard to, you know, you need to hire someone like us to do this, which it's okay, but that's not, I don't want to build my business because I bought a product that no one can use. So, you know, we had that feedback. Google has the same feedback. And honestly, in the beginning, we didn't know. Like, they were talking internally, we talked internally. And then, you know, we become friends in the community, and I went to a dinner with Louis Ryan, who back then was he is the founder founder of Estio, and he was basically 20 years in Google running networking, and he basically was in Google the main person there, and I came to California, and we kind of like met for dinner, and while we talked, we kind of like hint to each other, and we honestly understood really quickly that we're basically building the same thing internally. And also today, by the way, Luis Insolo is our CTO. He moved to us. But I mean, basically when we understood this, we said, okay, so maybe we should join forces, and that's how it's happening. In terms of the customer, look, we had a lot of customers, so we get that feedback, and they had a lot of customers, get the feedback. So the feedback was from the customer way more than the community, unfortunately. Because the main adopter from the community was people that has 10 people and can on the team and savvy engineer. But we wanted everybody to use it. That's why we're building software. You want to help everybody, right? So it was important to bring it to everybody. And I think that now, as I said, I'm excited.
So
yeah, go for
so
it.
I think one of those things that I thought was really neat in your talk this morning was around the estimated cost savings and automation and stuff like that. Talk to that a bit, because to me, that's a huge thing.
Oh, this is a huge, I mean, I can't reveal the number, but I don't know if you noticed, before my talk, there was a talk of one of our customers, HABC.
Yep.
And the amount of money that they save by moving to MBN, it's a mind-blowing. Like, if you discover, you will be in shock. I can't share it, unfortunately. Yeah. But, so, when we understood it, we said, listen, like, migration, going back to the trade-off, migration is always costly, right? So now, if I want to do that move, I need to know that eventually it will be worth it for me, because I need to put engineers to work on something that's theoretically working for me, right? Why would I do that? You will do it because it's beneficial for you. So to me, what we build is one tool, which is important, to basically estimate how much money you will save on infrastructure. But to be honest, I think in MBN, the big thing, which we're not saying enough, it's not about the infrastructure that you will say, which is important too. It's about the people.
Right.
What is, like, I can tell you, I'm running a company, so I can tell you that in my company, 80% of solo cost is basically for salaries, right? That's where majority, if I need, for instance, to raise, that's where I need to kind of like look at. So think about that. The real cost in the organization is the people. So if right now I can, instead of have 10 people, very, very important, you know, expensive engineer, only around 3 or 2. Mm-hmm. That's something that is insane, right? And I don't, that's the tool is not going to tell you, but I'm telling you, this is way beyond just what we're saving, but we felt that this is a good end for people to basically, it's a good start for them to do this. And honestly, it was requested by a customer that wanted to go to the management and convince them to move to MBN, but they didn't know how to do this. And we said, you know what? Here you go, right? We will help you with this. Does that make sense?
No, it makes perfect sense. And I think it's vital, and this is how you can do what you're doing. And I can see why you're feeling better about it. And that's an incredible impact, to your point. The cost savings of that, not just annually, but over time, it becomes an entirely different landscape and frees up some of that cognitive load and stress that developers or those folks operating those tools have to do. Speaking of people, you have a couple little people. And I'm curious to get your opinion as an executive in our world, building the future, as excited about AI as Rob and I both are. What do you hope that AI does for your family in the future, longer term?
Well, I think AI is doing a lot of stuff for me already, right? I mean, I'm not an English speaker. I'm originally from Israel. So English was a challenge for me. So I'm talking okay, but I'm not writing as much as I want. So for instance, to me, ChatGPT saved my life. I mean, I'm not sending an email without putting it there. I think that this is amazing thing for me. So, you know, it's already affecting all our life, honestly. What is going to do for me and my family? That's a good, interesting question. Yeah. I mean, I can tell you that I'm going back to the business because maybe it's the easiest to talk about it. But for instance, all my engineers right now has a license to Cursor. Mm. And that's in purpose, right? Because I really feel that the velocity is going drastically up. In terms of my family, that's a good question. I mean, listen, it will be everywhere. So to me, what I'm hoping that it will help. I don't know, my husband is a scientist. I know that there was a problem in science, like a protein folding, that took years for people to solve, right? I mean, and AI solved it in 2 seconds, right? So I really feel that in health, you know, in generally, what do I care in life? I care about health, right? I care about happiness, but mainly health. So I think that there it can make it tremendous, like, thing, but it will honestly in every aspect of life. So I'm actually
I totally agree with you.
Yeah.
All right, I've got one more question for you. When we're hanging out and having a chat with you in Amsterdam a year from now at the next KubeCon, well, the next KubeCon on this side of the planet, what do you hope to be able to say then that you can't yet say today?
It's a good question. I hope that, like, to me, this market moving so fast, the AI I'm talking.
Yeah.
So I feel that what I really, really wanted to say is that I have a lot of happy customers right now that are running the things that we are delivering right now, which is innovation to a lot of people. But I really, really wanted, I hope, that I will make a lot of people happy and building the platform that will be the future platform and have people happy, you know, save money, can sleep well at night because it will be resilient and so on and so on. I mean, just honestly execute on the promise. Like, I mean, we tend to talk a lot in this industry, and I to me, like, what I learned is that the best thing that I want is just put your head down and deliver, and that's to me is the thing that I'm hoping that I will be able to tell you that in a year, that we deliver off our promise and what we promise to people, and help, honestly, this infrastructure to be better, which basically, you know, think about it, there's so many customers here from everywhere. So basically, influence the world, right? Influence them, because if we give them the right infrastructure, they will build an amazing stuff on it. So honestly, like, that's how I see, you know, what we would like to do.
Well, I know Rob and I would both love to chat with you about that next year. Sounds awesome. Do keep us posted. This is such a blast. Thank you for sharing. Also, hello to your children. And thank you, Rob. This has been awesome.
This is great. I love this. It's a great topic. Great having you
great
on.
Great guest. Your energy is just a 10, just as a bonus. I hope the audience is able to get as much as I just got from that, wherever they might be hanging out. Because we're here in London, England at KubeCon and CloudNativeCon. My name is Savannah Peterson. You're watching theCUBE, the leading source for enterprise tech news.